السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم إلى يوم الدين. Why the religion of Islam can be described, as I said, as by one word. You can actually spend many talks discussing this one word. So all what I'm hoping today is that this talk will entice you to commit to study the subject further. Because frankly, its application is the key for your happiness in this life and in the hereafter. So Allah subhanahu describe in the verses that you just listened to, fi surah al-an'am, describe this religion of Islam as dinan qiyama. So the word actually I'm going to focus in is qiyama. So if you want to say what is Islam, he said it is qiyama. Allah subhanahu says fi surah al-an'am, which is verse 161, qul innani hadani rabbi ila siratin mustaqim. Say, as for me, my Lord has guided me into the straight path, dinan qiyama. And so qiyama, which I'm translating here as morally upright religion, millata Ibrahim hanifan, the way of Ibrahim the upright, Sayyidina Ibrahim the upright. So the term qiyama has two meanings, because it actually derived from two roots. One root referred to qa'im, which is standing upright. And the second root refers to qiyam, which is morality, and also referred to qima, which is a human value or a value. So one of the meaning of deen and qiyama means emphasize that Islam is the religion that provides the necessary guidance to make man an upright person. The other meaning, Deen and Qiyama, of Deen and Qiyama, that it emphasizes that Islam is the religion that establishes morality to ensure the value of humans and all Allah's creations. A similar single word to Qiyam that describes the nature of Islam is being as being morally upright religion that gives moral values to mankind. It's in Surah Ar-Rum. Allah subhanahu says, فَأَقِمْ وَجْهَكَ لِلدِّينِ الْقَيِّمِ. So set your face to the rightly valuable religion. قَيِّم means rightly valuable, valuable religion. مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ يَوْمٌ لَا مَرَدَّ لَهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ. And before the inevitable day comes, you know, that nobody, it's from Allah. So the foundation principle of morality in or moral principle in Islam is actually justice. And thus Allah subhanahu repeated this command of justice more than 15 times in the Quran. You know, as an example, we read in Surah An-Nisa, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, كونوا قوامين بالقسط شهداء لله ولو على أنفسكم أو الوالدين والأقربين إن يكن غنيا أو فقيرا فالله أولى بهما فلا تتبعوا الهوى أن تعدلوا وإن تلوا أو تعرضوا فإن الله كان بما تعملون خبير. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, here is one element of justice. Oh, you believe, stand firm all the time for justice, bearing true witness for the sake of Allah. Now, what you stand to witness now, where is the details now? Even if it is against, you stand witness of justice, even if it's against yourself, your parent, your nearest relatives, regardless whether one party is rich or poor, for Allah can best protect them, which means that don't be, you know, because a person poor, you be sympathetic to him. Justice does not have any color in that case. Wherever poor or rich, justice is justice. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, don't follow your whim such that you swiver or distort the testimony or turn away from the truth. Indeed, Allah is all aware of all that you do. Then Allah also emphasized the issue of justice even against your enemies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, كونوا قوامين لله شهداء بالقسط ولا يجرمنكم شنآن قوم على ألا تعدلوا اعدلوا هو أقرب للتقوى واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. O you who believe, stand out firmly for Allah, stand justice for Allah as a witness for justice, and do not let the hatred of some people induce you to deviate from justice. Be just. That is the next to the taqwa, and have taqwa of Allah, for Allah is ill aware, is well aware of all that you do. Now, the most grievous act of injustice man can commit is the one that committed against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is by the shirk. This was very clear to Luqman, and Sayyidina Luqman is the wise, Luqman al-Hakim, because it was the first advice that he gave to his son. And this is in Surah Luqman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs us what Luqman have advised his son. وَإِذْ قَالَ لُقْمَانُ لِبْنِهِ وَهُوَ يَعْذُ يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. Recall when Luqman said to his son, while he is advising him, my dear son, do not ascribe barters to Allah. Indeed, ascribing barters to Allah is a grave injustice. So even the belief in the oneness, the concept of monotheism, is actually a concept of justice. Because if you have any person who commits shirk, is actually committing injustice against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam emphasized the danger for anyone who commit injustice. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ittaqi da'wat al-mazlum." Be aware of the supplication of the oppressed, the person whom injustice have committed, that you might have committed injustice against him, because there is no veil between it and Allah. And in another hadith, be aware of the supplication of the oppressed, even if he is unbeliever or disbelievers. So injustice against any person, if that person raises his hand and they make a supplication to Allah subhanahu against you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will directly listen to this supplication. So while justice is the foundation of morality, injustice is the mother of all immoralities. A nation that commits injustice is condemned nation, even if it claims Islam as its religion. The moral principle of justice is clearly understood by Muslim scholar who said that the world will prosper with disbelief and justice, but it will not be fit with belief and injustice. So even if there is kufr in the world, but there is justice, then the world will be much better and successful than if you have a belief and then wide injustice being committed. Ibn Taymiyyah and other scholars have said that إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَنْصُرُ الْأُمَّةُ الْكَافِرَةُ الْعَادِلَةُ عَلَى الْأُمَّةِ الْمُسْلِمَةُ الظَّلِيمَةُ. Allah grants victory to the non-believing just nation over the unjust Muslim nation. So when you see the position of the Muslim today, then you realize what is happening. What is happening to us. You know, we as Muslims have been actually entrusted with this great moral message that delivers mankind from ignorance to enlightenment and from violence to eternal peace. And this is not an illusion or fantasy. I mean, what statement I just made is not something that, you know, a nice word that you say, because there is a practical application of it. You know, equipped with this message, the same message that we have now in our hand, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was able in within 23 years to transform the most backward and morally corrupt tribes of Arabia to be the world leader in knowledge, morality, spirituality, human brotherhood, freedom, and equality. In addition, within 50 years, these tribes were able to spread morality and human equality from China to Spain. You know, yes, most Muslims today perform all the rituals. They pray, they fast, they give charity, and go to the Hajj. But we do not see transformation of their status. When we look at many Muslim countries today, you will clearly see the disregard for justice, the disappearance of mercy, the lack of integrity, and even the lack of respect of human lives. You can see what is the extent of killing between Muslims in many Muslim countries. Where did we go wrong? The answer is very simple. Muslims have ignored the moral teaching of Islam and thus lost the meaning of proper ethics and upright character that are prerequisites for forming the honorable nation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expected when he said, "Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas." You have been, or you are, the best nation ever raised to mankind. It's actually amazing that the Quran has 6,348 verses. Of these verses, there are 4,505 verses that address the moral character and the ethics. You know, from both practical point of view and abstract point of view. So over 70% of the Quran talks about moral character. So where did we go wrong when we saying ignoring 70% of the Quran and want to claim to be believers? No wonder. Actually, this is a very interesting. When Allah wants to praise the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he did not praise him because he stand all night praying. He didn't praise him because he is the most generous person or charitable person. He did not praise him because of his courage. He did not praise him for anything, but he praised him with his good character. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him in Surah Al-Qalam, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. There is no praise to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Quran except by this, you know, that you have a noble and exalted character. Now, because the emphasis of Islam on ethics and moral character, Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah summarized the nature of Islam by saying, الدِّينُ كُلُّهُ خُلُقٍ. فَمَنْ فَاقَكَ فِي الْخُلُقِ فَاقَكَ فِي الدِّينِ. The religion is all but moral characters. So whoever surpasses you in good character surpasses you in religion. And the Prophet, you know, emphasized this point also, that he said that my exclusive mission, why Allah sent me here, he said, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. I have not been sent here except to perfect the moral ethics, a moral character. You know, the mission of the Prophet was not to merely correct the bad manners or bad character of the people, but to actually go far beyond this. This is to perfect the good ones. So if you are embraced as a Muslim, if you are embraced by the character of any person, you should strive to achieve even better character than the best characters of others. Find the most honorable person, the most generous, the most kind, the most patient, the most merciful, the most honest, and strive to be better than him if you want to be called, truly called a Muslim. You know, frankly, we can attend all the Islamic lectures and read all of the books that exist, but they will only be serving as mere entertainment for us, unless they motivate us to make us the best moral persons in the eye of everybody. So you really can ask yourself, and I am asking myself the same thing. In the sight of other people, I am the most, the best character, the most moral person. If I am not, then no lecture, additional lecture will listen. I will listen to that will change. Because I have to work on myself first, inside. And this is something that all of us have to do. You can sit down and look to the people you admire. You said, boy, this guy is the most generous. Look at his most kind. He's the most honest. And said, how can I be better than him? You know, many Muslims, we all, frankly, claim that we love the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But if we truly love him, then we should always strive to demonstrate the best character. Because this is what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said. He said, إِنَّ مِنْ أَحَبَّكُمْ وَأَقْرَبَكُمْ مِنِّي مَجْلِسًا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَحْسَنُكُمْ أَخْلَاقًا. The most beloved to me and the nearest to me on the day of judgment, it is not the one who prays the most, it is the one who has the best character. So while there is lack of moral and ethical behavior in a society, when there is a lack of moral and ethical behavior in society, destructive forces manifest themselves, and frankly we see it. And this occurs when the tarbiyah, and here is, I'm going to have two terms, you know, that you heard it, I'm sure they exist also in Urdu, tarbiyah and tazkiyah. It's hard sometimes to translate tarbiyah, but I'm translating tarbiyah as a moral teaching. Which is the moral teaching, this is part, should be part of our formal and informal education. And this is why educators say the first thing in reforming a society is tarbiyah, which is moral teaching. And the last thing is reforming society is tarbiyah. That means is tarbiyah is a process that you always, people have to always keep emphasizing and teaching each other. You know, we always say Islamic education, you know. What Islamic education does, it teaches about Islam. But the tarbiyah teaches about Muslims' character. You know, while the tarbiyah is done, can be done by the family, the school, the society, the goal is actually for the person himself to advance to the level and reaches a state of tazkiyah. And the tazkiyah is the purification of the self, the purification of the soul. So the tazkiyah, which is a purification of the self, this is a continuous process. It's a continuous improvement process that will instill in the person, in every one of us, the passion for justice, for mercy, for truthfulness, for generosity, for kindness, and so on. So the process of tazkiyah is a continuous process. Note that actually interesting that both the term tarbiyah and tazkiyah refer to increase in the person positive attributes and in the advancement of his high moral standard. If you look the root of the term tarbiyah, it's come from rabba. And rabba, actually rabba and rabba. Rabba means grow and increase. And this is, we see it, for example, in Surah Fussilat. وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنَّكَ تَرَى الْأَرْضَ خَاشِعَةٌ فَإِذَا أَنْزَلْنَا عَلَيْهَا الْمَاءَ اهْتَزَّتْ وَرَبَتْ. And then you see the signs that we, you know, and among his signs that you see on the land, you look at this inactive land, then once we send the rain to it, it stirs and rabat. Rabat means grow up. And also the word riba actually comes from it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Ar-Rum, وَمَا أَتَيْتُمْ الرِّبَى لِيَرْبُوا فِي أَمْوَالِ النَّاسِ فَلَا يَرْبُوا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. There is the word riba came several times here. Whenever the riba, which what is an increase of the amount of money you give, so that it may increase, yarbu means increase in the wealth of the people, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yarbu in the nas, it does not increase with Allah. So the word the tarbiyah is actually has this increase of something, and in this case, the increase of your moral attributes. Then now the term tazkiyah is similar, come from the term zakah, and coming from it, the word zakah also, and which means to purify, and to increase, and to grow, such as وَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّن زَكَاةٍ تُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَ اللَّهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُضْعِفُونَ. That whatever zakah you give, seeking Allah's pleasure, for those people, it will be multiplied for them. So their wealth will be multiplied. So when you give the zakah, it will increase your wealth. And Allah subhanahu says, also says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ تَزَكَّى وَذَكَرَ اسْمَ رَبِّهِ فَصَلَّى فِي سُورَةِ الْأَعْلَى. Success is surely achieved by the one who tazakka, purifies himself, and remembers the name of your Lord and offers the prayer. So the Quran makes it very clear that true success and the prosperity in this life and in the hereafter is reserved for those who seek to achieve the level of tazkiyah, that's through the purification and nurturing of their morals and the character. Allah subhanahu says to Surah Al-Shams, وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا, by the soul and the order he gave it, and then inspired it to know the wickedness and the righteousness, successful indeed is the one who zakka, nafsu means purifies himself. Allah also emphasized that those who achieve the state of tazkiyah, this purification, will be granted their place in heaven. As Allah subhanahu said in Surah Taha, وَمَنْ يَأْتِهِ مُؤْمِنًا قَدْ عَمِلَ الصَّالِحَاتِ فَأُولَئِكَ لَهُمُ الدَّرَجَاتُ الْعُلَى جَنَّاتُ عَدْنٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا. And then here is the end, وَذَلِكَ جَزَاءُ مَنْ تَزَكَّى. So whoever come to Allah as a believer having done righteous deed, for them are the highest ranks, gardens beneath which river flow. They will dwell therein for eternity. Such is the reward for man tazakka, the one who purifies himself. So the integration actually of moral education, which is the tarbiyah, and the tazkiyah, which is the purification of the individual soul, was the approach that the Prophet ﷺ used, you know, to teach, to implement with his companions. Now, the Prophet was the first teacher. And, you know, and this is why first teacher for, you know, for the Ummah, and Allah actually described the approach, the Prophet ﷺ approach in several verses with respect to the importance of tazkiyah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, for example, in Surah Al-Imran, لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعْثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمْ الكتابة والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لولا في ضلال مبين. Allah has indeed conferred a great favor on the believer when he sent for them a messenger from among themselves to recite for them the signs, and then ويزكيهم, purifies them, then ويعلمهم, teach them the Quran and the wisdom, while before that they had been in manifest error. So the tazkiyah comes actually ahead of teaching the Quran, because knowledge without pure heart and a purified soul does not lead to moral character and wisdom, but rather leads to mischief, chaos, injustice, betrayal, and aggression. Therefore, religious education without first reshaping a person's character and purifying his soul will never lead to anything of value. It actually can lead to a moral individual who manipulates the religion, the teaching of Islam, for selfish and corrupt motives. In fact, we are seeing these things, you know, this effect manifested in front of us now in many Muslim countries by the so-called Muslim scholar whom people have respected for, how they have manipulated the religion, the religious text, to rationalize injustice, justify immoralities, and defend the killing of innocent people. The only solution for these ethical and moral problems is to go back to the Prophet's approach of education. And this approach is understood and followed by early Muslims. The Prophet ﷺ invested a lot of effort on the tarbiyah and tazkiyah of his companions. As a result of this effort, the Prophet did not only leave for us a great message of Islam, but he also left a great generation who carried the message and spread it all over the land and were instrumental in moving humanity from darkness to the light. It is the quality of the people nurtured by the Prophet that constituted the secret behind the miracle of Islam. When a person becomes a Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ was committed to teaching him Islamic character and morals, and then teach him the Quran. And the Prophet would ask the companion to do the same, as he said to them when Umair ibn Wahb, you know, became a Muslim. He said, "Faqihu akhaakum fi dinihi wa qra'uhu al-Quran." Teach your brother the morals of the religion, and then make him read the Quran. And the early generation of Muslim clearly understood the importance of character development and success of the society. You know, Imam Ibn al-Mubarak said, you know, we have learned the moral character in 30 years, and we learned the knowledge, which is the Quran and the Hadith and the rest of it, in 20 years. That means that learning the moral character is a continuous process. You know, Imam Ibn al-Hasan also said, we are more need for moral character than for many of the Hadith. Imam Hasan al-Basr said, by Allah, he has not learned the Quran. He memorized its words and wasted its principle to the point that you hear one of them say, I have read the whole Quran, but you do not see any effect of the Quran on his manners or his deeds. And this is what we see it, frankly. You see people who memorize the Quran, studied, you know, in Al-Azhar or Medina, and you look at their character and you said, Subhanallah. You know, this is what knowledge does to them. The Prophet teaches us that without good character, there is no paradise, even if the Muslim performs prayer and fasts. And this is a hadith on Anas. And Prophet ﷺ, he said, the servant of Allah reached with good manners the highest level in the hereafter and secured the most honorable ranks, even if he is weak in his ibadat, in his rituals, you know. And he reaches the lowest level in hell by his bad manners, even if he is a worshiper. And the Prophet ﷺ said that the believer reaches with his good manner the same level of the person who spends all night praying and all day fasting. All the teaching of the Quran will remain, frankly, in conbaber unless they turn into life through a human being who translates the principle and meanings of the teaching through his behavior, actions, and feeling. This is the legacy of the Prophet ﷺ, who transformed Allah's revelation to a living human being who walks, talks, eats, sleeps, guided by the morals of Allah's book. This is exactly what Sayyida Aisha meant when she was asked about the character of the Prophet ﷺ. It is reported by Imam Muslim that Sa'd ibn Hisham came to Sayyida Aisha and asked her, O mother of the believer, inform me about the character of the Prophet. So Sayyida Aisha told him, don't you read the Quran? And he said, yeah, I read it. She said, the character of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the Quran. And Sa'd said, I decided that this is sufficient for me, that I don't need to ask anyone else until I die. You know, the mother of the greatest scholar, Sufyan al-Thawri, who knows the role of tarbiyah and tazkiyah, he knows the role of this moral standard, used to tell her son, which is Sufyan al-Thawri. Sufyan al-Thawri is a well-known scholar. She used to tell him, oh, my dear son, take these 10 dinars and learn 10 hadiths. And only if I find them, it changes the way you sit, the way you talk, the way you walk, and the way you speak to people. Come back to me and I will give you more money. Because my biggest fear is that your knowledge will be cursing you on the day of judgment if it doesn't change your character. No. So this wise woman knew that there is no value of religious knowledge without transformations of the person's character as reflected by the person's moral and honorable behaviors. You know, if the only difference between a Muslim and non-Muslim is the performance of rituals, we will never be successful. All the rituals in Islam are not intended as aims for themselves. You know, they are intended to serve as means for purifying and perfecting the Muslim characters. Good characters is the soul of the ritual, and therefore bad character invalidates all acts of rituals. Prayers have a very important purpose, and it is to develop a noble character and perfect the manners of the Muslim, as Allah subhanahu says, وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةِ إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. Establish the prayer. Why? For the prayers restrains from shameful and evil deeds. The goal of our daily prayer is to develop our characters, to always abstain from all forms of evil and obscenity with our words or deeds. And in Hadith Qudsi, Allah subhanahu says, I only accept the prayers from the one who is humble in my face, in the face of my majesty, who is not arrogant over my creations, who does not insist on my disobedience, who spends the day in my remembrance, who is merciful toward the poor, the stranger, the widow, and the sick. This is the one whom the Prophet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept his prayer, which is the humility, you know, and then being merciful and kind with all of those who are in need. Similar to prayer, zakah. Zakah is intended to purify and sanctify us, and thus instill the character of kindness and sympathy. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُطَهِّرُهُمْ وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا. Take from them a charity, zakah, you know, to purify and sanctify them with it. Fasting is the same thing. You know, Allah states that the goal of fasting is to increase our righteousness, our awareness of Him. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Oh, you believe fasting is prescribed for you as it has been prescribed for those who were before you. Why? In order that you achieve taqwa, you achieve righteousness, you achieve full awareness, consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, and Abu Huraira reported that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if one does not abandon falsehood of words and deeds, Allah has no need for him abandoning his food and the drink. The Hajj also is intended to serve as a journey to help us perfect our character and test our excellent manners. Because in the Hajj, you see people from different culture, from different countries. So how are you tolerant to all of these changes? And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this condition for the Hajj. Al-Hajj ashhurun ma'lumat. Faman farada fihinna al-Hajj, fala rafasa wala fusuqa wala jidala fil Hajj. That for Hajj, the months is well known. If anyone undertakes that duty, let there be no obscenity, no wickedness, no disputes during the Hajj. So if you're doing the going around the Kaaba and somebody push you, you cannot shout at him or scream to him or start arguing with him. And I'll finish with this, you know, with this hadith. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, أنا زعيم ببيت في ربض الجنة لمن ترك المراء وإن كان محقا. This is a very interesting hadith. I guarantee a place in the outskirts of paradise for the one who gives up disputing while he is right. And the Prophet ﷺ continues and says, and I guarantee a house in the middle of paradise for the one who abandoned lies, even when he is joking. And I guarantee a palace in the highest place in paradise for the one who has good character. You know, I really hope that this talk will be a catalyst actually for you to go study, particularly I said so many verses in the Quran talk about the moral character. Study the subject further and know all of the element of the good character and strive to go beyond them and to have the best character. This, frankly, is what Islam is all about. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa ashabihi. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وبارك اللهم لنا فيما أعطيت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت فإنك يا ربنا تقضي بالحق ولا يقضى عليك. اللهم أخرجنا برحمتك من عبادك الصالحين. اللهم أخرجنا من ظلمات اللهم أدخلنا برحمتك في عبادك الصالحين. اللهم أخرجنا من ظلمات الجهل والوهم إلى نور العلم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فاتبعونا أحسنه. اللهم أوزعنا أن نشكر نعمتك التي أنعمت علينا وعلى والدينا وأن نعمل صالحا ترضاه. اللهم اصلح لنا في ذريتنا إنا تبنا إليك وإننا من المسلمين. اللهم اكفنا بحلالك عن حرامك وبطاعتك عن معصيتك وفضلك عن من سواك. اللهم بفضلك ورحمتك على كلمة الحق والدين. اللهم انصر الإسلام وعز المسلمين يا أكرم الأكرمين. Oh Allah, spread your mercy upon us, shower us with your blessings, increase our knowledge, grant us forgiveness, and reward us with the company of the prophets in the Firdaus al-A'la. O Allah, purify our heart, strengthen our faith, increase our knowledge, and make us benefit from what you have taught us. O Allah, forgive our parents, grant them your mercy, make their graves a garden from heaven, and grant them the Firdaus al-A'la. O Allah, we have friends and relatives who have passed away. O Allah, we have our dear brother, Dr. Alam Akhtar, and also our friend in India, Iqbal Sheikh, they have passed away. Oh Allah, they are now under your care and the protection. So Allah, protect them from the trial of the grave and from the torment of the fire. Oh Allah, forgive and have mercy upon them, pardon them, and make honorable their reception. Surely you are the oft forgiven, most merciful. Oh Allah, remedy our sick and grant them full and speedy recovery. O Allah, grant our son Maraj and all our sick relatives and friends a speedy and full recovery. O Allah, you alone is the ultimate cure. There is no cure but yours. O Allah, grant them a cure that leaves nothing of injury or ailment. O Allah, grant us the ability to be grateful for your favor, which you have bestowed upon us and upon our parents, and that we may do righteous deeds that are pleasing to you. O Allah, guide our children, protect them and make them righteous. O Allah, we seek from you all of the good, whether we know it or we don't. And we seek your refuge from all evil, whether we know it or we don't. O Allah, we ask you with every name you have elected for yourself, that none of us leave this gathering, but his pains have been relieved, his worries have been removed, his debts have been paid, his weaknesses have been concealed, his sins have been forgiven, and his needs have been fulfilled. O Allah, you said, "Ud'uni astajib lakum." Ask me and I will respond to you. O Allah, we are asking you as you have commanded us. O Allah, accept our dua. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adada khalqih wa rida nafsih wa zinat arshih wa midada kalimatih. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adada khalqih wa rida nafsih wa zinat arshih wa midada kalimatih. سبحان الله وبحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزنة عرشه ومداد كلماته والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خير المرسلين. اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.